That's all right. We have a wonderful young lady this morning to baptize, and we've been privileged to get to know not only her but her family, who recently moved here from Texas. And she's been visiting here, coming to Awana the last couple of weeks. And I was able to sit down with her folks and herself on Wednesday and talk about her salvation and how that she's trusted the Lord. And we were coming from game time 2 weeks ago in Awana. And as we were finished with game time, she's in the TNT. She said, "I want to get baptized. I trust the Lord. I've been saved." I'm like, "Okay." She said, "I want to get baptized this Sunday." I'm like, "Well, let's talk to your parents." "Well, we've already talked about it. It's all good. We're going to do this." I'm like, "Okay, we'll just get with them and you tell them." But it was so great to see her zeal and her passion for the Lord in just a young age and knowing that Christ has saved her. So I'm going to ask her to come down now, if you would. As I was talking to her folks, they said, "We remember a baptism where the heater broke a long time ago, and it was frigid." I'm like, "Well, we'll make sure it's not this time. We've had that happen to us before, so it's a little warm, isn't it?"
Yeah.
So, Maya, have you trusted Christ as your Savior?
Yes.
Okay. Maya, because you've trusted Christ as your Lord and Savior, I now baptize you, my sister, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Ghost. Buried in the likeness of his death, raised to walk in newness of life.
Let's stand and read the Word of God together this morning. We'll be in Psalm 37, verses 23 through 29. I'll read verse 23, you read verse 24, and we'll follow along from there. Verse 23 says, "The steps of a good man are ordered by the Lord, and he delighteth in his way." "I have been young, and now I'm old. Yet have I not seen the righteous forsaken, nor his seed begging bread."
"He is ever merciful, and lendeth, and his seed is blessed."
"Depart from evil, and do good, and dwell forevermore." Let's read verse 29 together. "The righteous shall inherit the land and dwell therein forever." Let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for the privilege of coming together to worship you another Sunday, another Lord's Day. We just lift up the day to you, put you in your rightful place, and we ask you to bless us as we seek to worship you in spirit and in truth. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
To God be the glory. To God be the glory. To God be the glory for the things he has done. With his blood he has saved me. With his power he has raised me. To God be the glory.
Wonderful. Thank you, choir, for that wonderful song. And thank you. Oh, out here already. Great. And we're glad to have Richard Jessica's mom from Texas, correct? From Texas, Miss Gloria. So thank you for being with us today. If you're visiting today, we're thankful that you're here. And we'd like to have a record of your visit if you're so inclined. If you find in the front of your pew there, there's a visitor card. If you want to fill that out and just fill it out, drop it in the offering plate a bit later or at the end of service, you can take it to the Welcome Center. Would be great. If this is your first time or first time in a long time, we just want to welcome you. I'm going to ask my wife to come say a word about the ladies' activity that's coming up in October and also what happened on this past Thursday with their ladies' luncheon.
That makes it sound like something bad happened. We had a great time at our ladies' lunch this past week, and we had a nice group of ladies that were able to come, and we really had a good time. Coming up, however, there's a sign up in the back, October 8th, a Saturday morning at 10:30. We are going to have just a ladies' craft fellowship fun time. There's a picture on the sign up of what we're going to be making. And next week, Brenda's not here this week. She's the one who is amazing and got all this together. But anyways, we'll have the actual real thing to show you. But it's going to be a cost. There's going to be $5 for each person. And if you are coming, if you could sign up in the back so that we can get a count and make sure we have enough of what we need, that would be great. So do that today. Start signing up, and we will have a great time.
Also, next Sunday is our Youth Sunday, so after the morning service, if you're a teenager, young person, or if you just like to hang out with the young people and want to be a part of that, we're going to go grab some fast food. We're going to go down to Palatka, going to Putnam Lanes, and from about 1 o'clock is when we're going to get there, about 1 o'clock till 3, 2 hours of bowling. That's $9 a person. That's all you can bowl. That's your shoes included, and we're going to be taking them down there. We'll provide transportation, so if you want to be a part of that, just sign up at the back. Write your name down, how many's in your party, so we can let them know. The next Sunday night is our ice cream fellowship at 6 o'clock, so come back. Sunday evening, we'll provide all the toppings and all the fixings, so if you want to bring homemade ice cream, you want to go buy ice cream, whatever it is, just bring your favorite ice cream, and we'll meet in the fellowship hall and have just a brief service, but a big fellowship next door. And I think that's it. We have a Legacy Men's Lunch coming up on the 29th. We're going to Alachua. We're going to go to Brown's Country Buffet. So men, if you can help us out by signing up for that, if you're available that day on Thursday, or you're retired, or you can just take some time off, we're going to provide transportation. We'll leave here at 10 o'clock to drive down there. They open at 11, and that'll give us plenty of time.
In and out of situations, that tug of war in me. All day long I struggle for answers that I need. But then I come into His presence, and all my questions become clear. And for this sacred moment, no doubt can interfere. In the provided a place for us to rest, a place to find the answers in the hour of distress. Now there is never any reason for you to give up in despair. Just slip away and breathe His name. He will surely meet you there. In the
First Corinthians chapter 5. Today we're going to conclude this rather challenging chapter in our, I guess, bend in the river as we're looking. We've been in First Corinthians for well over a year now, and we've come to the first bend in the river, and this particular section of Scripture we've covered now for 2 weeks, and today we're going to come out of this and hopefully answer. We're going to ask then answer three particular questions that Paul addresses here. And of course, this particular chapter, chapter 5, is dealing with sexual scandal in the church. It's not your everyday Sunday morning type of message, but it's one that kind of greets us as we make our way through the New Testament. And so Paul's writing to a church that refused, not didn't forget or overlook, but they refused to deal with this particular sexual scandal in the church. And what is that? As Paul's writing, there was someone in an incestuous relationship with this man with his stepmother. And he had written to them previously about handling this issue. And you say, well, the church, these are kind of things that, I didn't think went on in the church. And yet we look around our world today, as we've seen, and there are scandals that pop up here and there, and many times in churches, the way they're handled, one, they're either not talked about at all, they're avoided altogether, they're swept under the rug in some cases. But in Paul's case here, as he's writing to the church that he founded, he's saying to them, you wouldn't deal with this, so now I'm going to have to. And what he does, he lovingly yet firmly and biblically rebukes them, and then he brings about some swift judgment. So the church, of course, has lost its way. They were worshiping God. They were full of power, and there were a lot of gifts. They were a very loving church, but yet they had become proud. They were very arrogant. They were fighting amongst themselves over who the best preacher was. and who had the best gifts among them. And where they are fighting over those things, they were actually other worse things that were going on in the church. In chapter 6, as we're going to see in the coming weeks, there were members of the church that were taking one another to court. They were suing each other. Now imagine that, coming to church, and someone that sits on this side is suing someone on that side, and they've been in court all week, and here they are in the fellowship together. Or there's someone in the church, as he writes in chapter number 5, someone living in this relationship, this sexual immorality, and they're sitting right there on the third pew. And they're just welcomed in, and they're participating in service like they're doing nothing wrong. And Paul says, the reason this is important is because God will not be mocked. His church is to be holy, and we are to live different lives because God has saved us. And so chapter 5 presents a lot of issues for us in the world we live in, because it's none of our business, the world would say today. And many Christians, who are you to judge me and what I do and the choices that I make? And what we see here, Paul is going to remind Christians in this day and us today that if you are a believer, you're a follower of God, you are bought with a price, you are a new creation, so therefore we are to follow God and give Him everything. Our life is not our own. So therefore, as Paul writes, we should present ourselves a living sacrifice, wholly acceptable unto God, which is our reasonable service, and we should not be conformed to this world. The world, the culture is telling you, you can do this and get by with it. You can take this and it not hurt you. You can do these things and still fit in and still love Jesus. And the question for us today as Christians, we have to ask, can I have a little bit of what I want and a little bit of what God wants for me and it still be okay? And by what I want, meaning the things of this world. Can I walk with the world, put my hand in their hand, and can I put my hand in the hand of God and we walk together? Of course, we know the answer to that, but we live in 2022 where it's kind of apropos to do what you want to do. Life's a beach, man. Live any way you want. And if you're a Christian, it doesn't really matter. You can live your life. And if they tell you what from the Bible, just go to a different church or find new friends or just find a new voice to listen to. There's always going to be voices out there that agree with what we want or what our flesh craves. But the Bible is God's word. It's His standard. It is what we must do. And we do that because He loves us and we love Him. So chapter 5, we've already looked the last 2 weeks. Here were the 3 points. We saw the sad reality of sexual sin. It was present in the church. There was no escaping it. Number 2, we saw the shameful reaction to the sexual sin in the church. The church paraded it. They did not do anything about it with it. They were proud of it. Well, it's fine. Then number 3, we said last week, there was a serious response to sexual sin. And that was, he said, I'm going to turn this person, he literally uses the words, over to Satan. It's pretty harsh. I'm going to treat this man like he's an unbeliever. So church, you should have done this, but since you won't, and this man will not repent, therefore God is going to turn him over, and we should turn him over to let him do what he wants to do, and the devil's going to get a hold of him. And then if he repents, this should draw him back to repentance, and he says to God, I'm sorry, he'll make things right, not only with the Lord, but with the church family. But he says, right now, what you're doing is not good. So as we close the chapter, and in dealing with this sexual scandal in the church, Paul's going to ask 3 questions. Let's go to number 1. Number 1, here's the first question. Why does it matter? Why does it matter? There are a lot of things in our church and in our world that we're facing that, you know, as we come to Scripture, some people say, why does that even matter? No, just let people love who they want to love. Let them live how they want to live. It doesn't really matter. Why does it matter, Paul? Why are you bringing this up? Pastor Jason, why does it matter in Keystone Heights? Because surely this doesn't go on around here. We've got 75 churches in a 5-mile radius. Everybody knows the truth. Why does it matter? Leave this alone. Let's talk about Jesus and His love for us, which we're going to do. And because Jesus does love us, He loves the truth. He is the truth, the way, and the life. So therefore, we must talk about the truth. So why does it matter? Look at verse number 6. Verses 6 through 8, Paul answers this question, why does it matter? He says, verse 6, your glorying or your boasting, your pride is not good. Know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? Purge out therefore the old leaven, that ye may be a new lump, as ye are unleavened. For even Christ, our Passover, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness, but with the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. Now, we're at 10:30. We're one of those few weird churches that meet early. So you've had breakfast, your stomach is not growling, and you'll get out just in time to go right to lunch. But I was talking to my parents the other day, and for some folks, they still like the Golden Corral. Now, 2020, Golden Corral kind of suffered a little bit, you know, the buffet and all this. But the one thing I loved as a kid, certain restaurants, and I think it was around when I was younger, was they called it the Big Fat Yeast Rolls. Anybody remember that? Oh, my goodness. I can just still picture those things. And my mom would always say, don't fill up on the bread. And you know, when they do that, you go to a steakhouse, you go to any place, even Olive Garden, the breadsticks. I mean, I get the soup, but I need to have 17 breadsticks just to help me with the soup. And then you're not ready to eat when the food comes. Well, Paul, to prove his point about why does it matter and how do we deal with sexual scandal or sin in the church, he goes immediately to food. It's interesting. So note what he says here, verse 6, know ye not that a little leaven leaveneth the whole lump? So Paul is going to give them a history lesson, and he's going to give them kind of this Bible tutorial on describing sin and salvation, why it's important and why it matters. So first of all, let's talk about sin. What is sin? Sin is a violation of God's law. Now, if you ask the man on the street, let's get 10 different responses to what is sin, what is morally wrong, you might get 10, 15 different answers. Some say, nothing's wrong. I'll do what I want to do. I make it up as I go along. But according to God's standard, sin is a violation of God's law. It is breaking God's law, doing what is wrong based on what God says is right, what we should not do. So Paul is going to talk about the nature of sin, a violation of God's law. So sin is a violation of God's law, but how does sin work? This is what he's going to prove here. How does sin work? And he illustrates this using bread. Now, you're looking at the wrong guy if you want to know anything about food prep at all. I know to put things in the fridge, and when it's expired, you know, the sniffer, you can smell it, throw it out. There are certain things, like I was joking about my son, Joe, he's 10. Anything that grows from the ground has leaves on it, and it has some color to it. It's poison to him. Don't eat. And we had black-eyed peas last night. So we had, my wife made this ranch chicken last night. So we had ranch chicken. You say, what is that? I remember because I said, oh, that's the poor man's meal. Because when my wife and I first got married, we had ranch chicken. And basically, it sounds like it is. It's something, it's very simple, but it's something very good. We had ranch chicken, we had black-eyed peas, and we had couscous. Anybody have couscous? You know what that is? Four people, great, okay. It was delicious, it was great. But you're talking to the wrong guy if you're talking about food prep. I don't know much about it. Paul knows a little bit, but the point is not his skills in the kitchen. His point is to give them a history lesson about how sin works and what sin does to people that carry it or that participate in it or that allow it to have an effect in their life. What does he say here? He's illustrating this particular subject of sexual sin in the church by talking about the leaven that is used in bread that causes it to rise. And he says, a little leaven, just a little bit, it leavens the whole lump. And in this day and age, this little piece of dough was left out overnight and with some water, and they would stick it in so that when it was baked, it would rise. And what he's saying here, just a little bit of this will cause the whole thing to rise, just like a little bit of sin in someone's life will cause the whole thing to have this effect. So a little bit of sin in the church will corrupt or infect the entire church. A little bit of sin in my life and in your life will have the same effect. So the question is, as we look in two ways, number one, corporately as a church, that's who he's writing to, the church at Corinth. He's writing to the church as a whole. He says leaven or sin has come into the church and the whole church refuses to deal with it. There's a problem. But secondarily, let's talk about it for us today. A little bit of sin in our life that maybe no one knows about, that maybe you're dealing with, something that you're hanging on to or something that it won't let go of you and you're not sure how to rid yourself of it, what will it do to the individual? He's talking to saved people here. If we don't deal with our sin, it will deal with us. There will be some effect in our life. And Paul is saying, this is how sin works. In Matthew chapter 16, Jesus said to the Pharisees, to the disciples, beware of the leaven of the Pharisees. They will take a little bit of this judgmentalism or the law, and they'll plug it in there. Yes, sure, Jesus is the only way, but you got to do something to get to heaven. Jesus is good, but you've got to be good too. And I'll tell you this, according to God's word, not by works of righteousness that we have done. If I could get to heaven based on my own good works or your good works, why did Jesus come to die upon the cross for us? This is what Paul is writing. Our sin that we play with, that we have in our life that no one sees, no one knows, and we are trying our best to either rid ourselves of it or we're not ridding ourselves of it. He says it will have an effect. The story of Achan in Joshua chapter 7 and 8. We won't dwell on this long, but the story of Achan, you know the story. Achan was part of the soldiers that went into the promised land with the Israelites. And when they came into this one city, they were told, don't touch any of the spoil. Don't touch any of the goods, the gold, the garments. Don't touch any of this stuff. Don't bring it back. Don't touch it. Don't mess with it. And what did Achan do? He saw some of these things after they raided the city, after they came in and God gave them the victory. He took some things that he thought were desirable. He took some money, took some garments, he took some stuff. He went home. They lived in tents, remember that. He went home, he dug a hole. Basically, he put the things in his basement and he hid them. He covered it over. And they went, the nation of Israel went to war the very next chapter. And they lost, and a lot of people lost their lives. And Joshua was told by God, there is sin, there's leaven or sin in the camp. Something is wrong. And until you deal with the sin in the camp, you can't go forward. You're not going to win. There won't be victory. And so Joshua, being led by God, went from tribe to tribe. There were 12 tribes. There were no doubt hundreds of thousands, if not millions of people. They went down the line, the heads of the tribes, the elders, all of these folks, till they came to this one particular tribe, and there was Achan, this man. And Achan said, it was me. He said, I saw these things. They pleased me. I wanted them. I took them. I buried them. And here they are. And they had to deal with the sin. You know, in the New Testament, James chapter 1 talks about how sin works. We often, you know, we can't legislate morality, by the way. That's not the church's job. We're not here. We're here to tell people what the Word of God says. But you and I, we can't make people do right. Heck, we have a hard enough time making our kids do right. We can't make them do right. We talked about this in Sunday school. Solomon said in Proverbs chapter 1, my son, if sinners entice thee, don't consent, don't give in. But eventually dad stays at home and the son, the daughter, the kids have to leave the house and make their own choices. So what Paul is saying here, you and I, we make our own choices. And if we choose to sin, it's based on what we see, based on what we feel, based on what makes us feel good. And so Paul's writing to the church at Corinth, and he's saying, the nature of sin is that just a little bit will infect the whole lump. And there are only two reactions to sin. And I like, this is not original with me. I heard another preacher say this. It is either repent or repeat. Repent or repeat. All of us can get caught in that vicious cycle. Repent or repeat. Where we've done something wrong, we are confronted about it. Someone says, you shouldn't do that. Maybe it's your mom, your dad, it's your spouse, it's your parent, it's your child, it's a friend, it's an authority figure. You shouldn't do that. The Bible says, and they're saying it in love, and even if they're saying it in judgment, you shouldn't do that. You have a response. I'm going to repent or I'm going to repeat. I'm going to make this right because it will please God and ultimately it will help me because if I repeat this, it's going to hurt me. So Paul says, your glorying is not good. Church, you're celebrating this guy living an open, rebellious sin with his stepmom in church. And you think that's bad. Just wait till we get through the rest of Corinthians, where they're coming to church smashed out of their mind, drunken to the Lord's table. They're drunk. They're gluttonous. They're living this life thinking, you know, my belly is my God. I'll do what I want. No one can tell me what to do. I got my get out of hell free card. I'm going to heaven. I'm a Christian, so I'll live with liberty. Well, liberty is not a license to sin. And so Paul is correcting the church, saying, sin a little bit will hurt you. Number two, he speaks about the nature of salvation. So what does it mean to sin? To break God's law, a violation of God's commandment. What is salvation? Salvation, for by grace are you saved. G-R-A-C-E, some people have said. God's riches at Christ's expense. Jesus gave his life for me and for you. He died on the cross for our sin. Jesus died for us. He has forgiven us. And when we come to him in faith and we receive the free gift of salvation that is presented to the entire world, Jesus came, the Bible says, to seek and to save the wealthy. He came to seek and to save the white. He came to seek and to save America. He came to seek and to save the poor. No, he came to seek and to save the lost. That's everybody, because we are in one of two families if we are in this world. We're either lost or we're found, we're saved. And so often in church and in politics and in this world, it gets politicized. But Jesus categorizes and God categorizes humanity into two classes, lost and found. And if you haven't been found by the Lord, he has presented it. He has sent out the light. He has died on the cross. He is here standing ready to forgive you of your sin. So he's going to demonstrate to them why it's important that we talk about this, because of sin's effect and then the nature of salvation. Look at verse 7, the last part. For even Christ, our Passover lamb, is sacrificed for us. Therefore, verse 8, let us keep the feast, not with old leaven or old bread. Think of the moldy bread that someone forgot about in the back of the pantry. It's been there since 2020. You probably know by now it's still there. So don't live your life like the old bread. Don't eat that stuff. Don't put that stuff in your body. Don't partake of the feast. He's talking about with the family of God here, with old leaven, neither with the leaven of malice and wickedness. My youth pastors say, if you're happy and you know it, notify your face. Now, there are a lot of ball games on yesterday, and there were a lot of reactions, and I always like the camera panning the crowds in those moments. It's sheer desperation at some points. We're going to lose this game. And then the next minute, they're just like, I saw one video of the App State win, and it was showing, I don't know exactly where it's at, but it's not in the stadium. People are outside at a bar area. They're drinking, and they're all out there, and it's that last Hail Mary play, 58-yarder. And I noticed the guy in the blue shirt. And the guy in the blue shirt is standing there. The TV screens are here. He's standing here with a drink talking to his friends. And everybody else is kind of watching. And then the play happens, the Hail Mary pass, and they win. And they're cheering. He's, oh, yeah, here we go. Yeah, he's cheering. What we see here is sometimes when we come to church, people come, they're aloof or they are doing their own thing. They're not focused on what God has for them. And here he says, the bread of malice and wickedness, meaning they are coming in with an agenda. They're getting together, gathering with the saints, and they can't get along. But he says, don't come with malice and wickedness. Don't come with sin that's been unresolved in your own life. You're taking that old bread from 2020 that's moldy. It's got things growing on it. There's stuff happening. It smells. It looks terrible. You're bringing it with you. He says, but the unleavened bread of sincerity and truth. You're speaking the truth in love to those that are in God's family. You are not speaking it to them without speaking it to yourself. That's why the Bible says that we should examine ourselves. We have a lot of church people from the pulpit to the pew, from the Baptist to the Methodist to the whoever they might be, looking at everybody else. I wonder if he's saved. Look at that guy over there. I wonder if, well, she's definitely not a Christian. Look at them over there. Whatever it might be. The Bible is always implicit with this. Examine yourself. Look at you before you start picking up the stones to throw at others. Look at yourself. That is not your job. We looked last week. That is not my job. That is not the denominational job to cast stones at anybody. Our job is to speak the truth of God in love with sincerity and tell them, there go I, but by the grace of God. And in fact, that used to be me, and now He's found me. He's redeemed me. So the whole point of the nature of salvation is, and what does this have to do with sexual sin, is that sin will cost you more than you want to pay. As the song says, it'll take you further than you want to go. It'll keep you longer than you want to stay. And if you and I don't deal with the sin in our life, it will do something to us. It will damage us. It will damage our relationships. He's also pointing out, look at verse 7, Christ our Passover is sacrificed. What is he talking about? This is from Exodus. When they left almost in the middle of the night, they had to pack their things. The last plague on Egypt was presented. The death of the firstborn. They had the Passover lamb. They had to take the blood of that unblemished lamb. You remember in the book of Exodus? They had the blood in the basin. They took the hyssop and they basically applied it to the doorpost. And he says, when I see the blood, I will pass over you. You be ready to go. And that night they had to eat unleavened bread. They'd eat so fast that, you know, there you go. And he said, Christ is our Passover sacrifice. He is our lamb. Here's a quote from one commentary. It says, as it was unthinkable for Jewish people to keep the Passover without observing the Feast of Unleavened Bread, so it too is unthinkable for a Christian to claim Christ as Savior from their sin, but to continue to live in sin. That's why the Lord's table, we had this last week, last Sunday night. We observe the Lord's Supper, the Lord's table. We come together, a memorial of what Christ has done for us. But Christ, we don't re-crucify Christ. He's died for our sins. So when we come to the table and we have the bread and the juice, we are saying to God, I'm a part of this family. I have dealt with my sin because you have died for my sin. And if I don't deal with my sin is going to deal with me. And the issue Paul is saying in this church with sexual sin is that you're playing with sin and you're forgetting that you're saved. And there is a chance that many of us, although we've been redeemed, we've been transferred from darkness to light, we're in God's family, from the devil's family, and all of that. Do you know what's possible for Christians to go back to start living? I didn't say they lose their salvation. They can go back and start living like they used to live. We've all been there. Maybe it starts here. We've been hurt. We've been enamored with something. We got taken by it. We were tempted by it. We succumbed to it. Or we've gotten hurt in church. Someone said something, done something, and we're just like, I'm done with those hypocrites, those people. And we go back to living how we used to live before we knew Christ. That happens. Peter, the Bible says, he, when Christ was taken, he cussed several times to this young lady. And then he went back to his old life. He said, forget this. This is what it is. They crucified him. I'm next. I'm out of here. He went back to fishing. How many times have we thought those same things because of what we've been involved in or people that have hurt us? So Paul's writing here, I'm not trying to hurt you. I'm trying to tell you the truth of God's word will always expose the error in our lives, but never with judgment, but always with love. He does it with humility and grace. Let me give you one other quote. I thought this was great. This is a pastor. He wrote, the world is waiting to see a church, one which takes sin seriously, enjoys forgiveness fully, which in its time of gathering together combines joyful celebration with an awesome sense of God's closeness and authority. Now, whether or not you are like the Tim Hawkins type where you worship and it's like this, you're carrying the TV, or you're raising your hands, or you've got one hand raised, or your hands are in your pocket. You know, I grew up in a church where, in the church I grew up in, they ran the aisles. And you say, well, how did you, I've never seen you do that. Well, my dad didn't run the aisles. I think maybe a few times I saw my dad, you know, he got happy. That was my dad getting happy. That was it. But I'm telling you, I've, like many of you who grew up in church, you've seen some stuff and you've lived to tell about it, and yet here you are. What he's saying here, we come to church to worship God and to feel His presence, to hear from His Word and to be in fellowship with each other. That was disrupted in the church at Corinth. In fact, all it was for them was, look at me, here I am. Our name's on the reader board, didn't you see? Don't you know who you're talking to? We're just the greatest church around here. Look at us, listen to us, we are the best. Meanwhile, they were tolerating excessive and perverse sin within their midst. So that's the first question. The first question is, why does it matter? This is why it matters. You've been saved from sin. God has a plan for your life. Number two, quickly, we only have one other question. The second question not only is why does it matter, but who does this apply to or who is this about? So if we're going to go around dealing with sin, then who do we start with? We're not the Puritans, by the way. We're not going out and seeing if people float in the water or throwing rocks at them. But that's what some of the Pharisees were doing. So Paul's going to say, who is this about? Look at verse number 9 through 12 in your Bible or on your tablet. He says, verse 9, I wrote unto you in an epistle, a previous letter, not to company with fornicators or those who are immoral, living immorally sexually. Verse 10, yet not altogether, not all, with the fornicators of this world, or with the covetous, or extortioners, or with idolaters, for then must ye needs go out of the world, because basically it's everywhere. He says, I'm not telling you not to associate with people who are lost or who are not found in the world, verse 11, but now I have written unto you not to keep company, which means they're to associate or mix up with, not to associate or mix up with if any man that is called a brother, someone that's in the family of God, a fellow Christian, be a fornicator, they are living in sexual sin or covetous, selfish sin, an idolater, spiritual sin, or a railer, spoken sin, or a drunkard, substance sin, or an extortioner. Let me just alliterate. I can't say stealing sin. Stealing we know is wrong, but someone that steals. With such an one, know not to eat. Don't fellowship. We look at this. You look at verse 11. It's heavy. It's harsh. It seems mean. But this is what God's Word is saying here. What we have to chew on as we come to this text is, so Lord, there's someone that is living a life. Let's put ourselves in that perspective. Let's put a family member that we love, we care for. Let's put a friend who is there, someone that we have known, that they're living in such a way that they are almost living as someone that doesn't know God. Yet they said they have trusted Christ. They've been saved. They've been baptized. They are a member of a church. But they're living like someone that's unsaved. Paul says here, when someone is like that, you can love them, but you've got to create some distance. You've got to tell them the truth, but you can't drag that person, whether it's your spouse, your sibling, your child, your parent, your best friend, a relationship, you can't drag that person down the aisle, and you and I, we can't change their heart or their mind. That has to be the Lord. And what he's saying here is what we looked at in the first point. When we are confronted by our sin, we either have to repent or we will repeat. There's only one of two options. I need to make it right, or I'm going to go right back to it. Solomon has a graphic way of talking about sin. And he says in the book of Proverbs, as a dog returns to his vomit, basically, this person, this fool, returns to his folly. This sinner goes back to their sinning. Although, you know, it's kind of harsh analogy. Christians can go hard after things because we make the wrong choices. We put those wrong emphasis in our lives based on what feels good, what we want, what we think we must have. Don't judge me. Who are you to tell me? Why are we talking about this anyways? Ultimately, when we come to passages such as this, we have to see that God wants to preserve the holiness and the purity of each believer and of His church. Verse 12, for what have I to do to judge them that are also without or outsiders? Do not ye judge them that are within? Insiders? He says, it's not your job to go outside and call fire and thunder down on those people. It's also not your job to do it on the inside. He's not saying, just because you can't do it out there doesn't mean you need to come in here and be God to everybody. That's not what he's saying. We need to judge ourselves, verse 13. But them that are without, outside of the family of God, God judgeth. Therefore, put away from among yourselves that wicked person. So the world is illustrated here. Sins against yourself, he noted that. Sins against your neighbor, he mentions extortioner or someone that is speaking a railer, or sins against God himself, idolatry. That's how the world lives. So what are we to do with the outside world? We can't run from it or avoid it. We shouldn't be sinners are going to sin. Our job is to, what did Jesus say? Be salt and light. Your life and my life might be the only Bible that some people ever read. So in the outside world, sometimes we conflate those two. We mix them up. People who don't know the Lord, they need to see the love of God. They need to hear the truth of God, but they need to see it in my life, because they may never darken the door of a church. They may never crack open a Bible, but they're watching you, they're watching me, they're hearing your conversations, they're seeing how you drive, how we drive, and around here ain't nobody saved. Okay, no, good, I got a few laughs there. Eesh, just take your life in your hands there. They're watching us. But when it comes to the church, to Christians, when there is an issue and we have examined ourselves and someone says to us from a place of authority, as Paul is mentioning here, you need to deal with this. What's our response to that? Don't you tell me. Who do you think you are? So we can't avoid or run from the world, but we're not to conform to the world. Doesn't mean that you can't have friends with people who don't know Christ. You'd have to run from the world, go live in a cave, a monastery. God didn't call us to do that. He calls us to make connections, have compassion, and engage in conversations with the lost. Let people know that Jesus saves, that Jesus loves, that Jesus cares, that Jesus forgives, that Jesus invites, that he wants you to be part of his family, to let the lost know that. But for the family of God, he wants them to know, hey, you're my son or you're my daughter. You need to live like it. I'm sure there are things in your house that you would allow in your own home and things you won't allow. I'm sure there's, I don't know if types of food, you know, I'm not a big thing with butternut squash personally. Let's go to that. Anybody like butternut squash? Oh my goodness, I should have never even asked that question. My wife is going, she found like 15 friends. I don't know. Can't even. No, I just, butternut squash for me is no bueno. I just can't do it personally. Maybe in your house you like butternut squash, and in my house we don't, but yet it's still there. It shows up seasonally. In our homes, we allow or don't allow certain things, certain behaviors, perhaps certain shows, certain types of things, whatever it might be in your home. What does God say should happen in the church house? And more importantly than the brick and mortar here, this ain't the church. This is the building. You and I, we are the church. You're the church. So what does God expect, not of this building, but of these people who are here, that are gathered? So Paul answered the questions, why does it matter? Who is this about? And finally, the last question here, he says, what should you do about it? Look at verse 13. But them that are without God judgeth or judges, therefore put away from among yourselves that wicked but saved person. He's speaking to the church. By the way, this is the letter to the 1 Corinthians. We don't know this young man's name or his stepmother's name. It's not a letter addressed to them. It's a letter addressed to the church who refused to deal with this. So what should we do about it? Let's just be honest as we come to a close, how hard this can be to deal with. Now, let's put ourselves in this particular context. You go in the first century to this church. They didn't meet in buildings. They met in houses. They were saved. They came out from their lifestyles. Many of them were slaves. Some were wealthy. We know this. Some were just hardworking people. Some were Jews, Gentiles, whatever, all backgrounds in the church. The church becomes your family. And then someone in the family says, I'm going to do what I want to do, and I dare you to say anything about it. And they go and they try to, you know, reason with, talk with, whatever it might be, and the person's like, you've been to some Thanksgiving dinners like that. It's been awkward. Like, pull up the camera. This is going to go viral because, oh my goodness, this, I'm going to get a lot of likes on this, or I don't know. You've been to events with family where they've been like at each other verbally, even maybe physically. Paul saying here, church, in the family of God, how does God expect us to deal with something that's so difficult? The church is a family. You know, the greatest thing for me, or I'd say the hardest thing for me, and my wife would concur, we've talked about this many times, and it is different here culturally. So before we came to Florida, we were in New England. We were in New England for almost 17 years. Now, where we were at in New England, you have Boston, which is an hour, basically hour and a half away from us. And then you have the city. You have New York City, which is a little less than 2 hours away. And we're right there, right kind of in the middle, Hartford. And what you have in that area, you have within 45-minute driving distance, there's 1.7 million people, boom, right there. There's people everywhere. Even though there's country where we live, there was the woods, there were trees, there was grass, you could go and hike and all that stuff. You're surrounded by people. And what you had a lot of people that moved to that area for work. They moved there. You had immigrants. We had 14 different nationalities in the church. Ethiopia, Kenya, from Egypt, from England, from Italy, from Germany, from Jamaica, a ton from Jamaica, Canada. We had some from Florida, very few, because the people in that state didn't want to move up there. Most were moving from up there to come down here. But in the church, it was different because all those people had left their families to come work a job in that area, and then the church became a family. They have no family, but the family of God. And the one thing that I think for us was difficult when we first came, because and it's still, I think, a struggle for probably a lot of pastors in a lot of places, is that this is not that urban setting. It's not that place where family often leaves. And I left home when I was 18 years old to go off to Bible college to pursue God's call. And I've never lived home, and I've missed that. I've missed my parents. You know about all that. I miss my mom and my dad, my wife as well. But God hasn't called us to live at home or back near home. God's plan is for us to live with family, God's family. And in our context, in our culture here, many of you have family. You've been here for generations. And so often the danger can be this, that I saw there and I see here, is that so often we can get the family sideways. The family of God is who we're going to spend eternity with. And sometimes it's easy, especially when you have 75 churches in a 10-mile radius, I don't know, something like that. You've got a lot of churches. We can just change families anytime we want if there's a problem. Oh, boy, he's talking about sex again in church. Or, you know, Sister Bertha, she kind of looked at me funny, and she took my parking spot. And you know what? She ate that big fat yeast roll. She knocked it right out of my hand. She ate it. And I can't believe I'm going to the other church, whatever it might be. We change families so often, and God never designed it like that. So what did Paul say you should do to the church of Corinth? He said, you need to turn that person. He says, I've already turned him over to the devil. Let the devil have him. Treat him as an unsaved person. It wasn't harsh. It was difficult to hear. But in the family of God, we are a family. We might not be related by blood. We might have different backgrounds and experiences. We may come from different places or regions of the country. We might look different, speak different, work different jobs. But we're family. And the most important thread that can go through a chapter like this is that you can't forget your roots. You can't forget who placed you and who planted you and who loves you and who cares for you. And yes, churches can be tough and it can be difficult and it can get ugly. But the Lord Jesus Christ is faithful even when a preacher is not. Jesus cares for you even when sometimes the church turns their back on you. And that happens. God is always faithful. And when we stick to God's word and we do it God's way, we're going to be in God's will. Galatians chapter 6, verse 1, my final verse, he says, brethren, if a man be overtaken in a fault, ye which are spiritual, restore such an one in the spirit of meekness, considering thyself, lest thou also be tempted. If we see a brother, if we see a family member struggling, they're caught in some sin, they have... Consider yourself. Lord, what am I dealing with? Lord, how can I help? Lord, use me to be a blessing. Lord, I don't want to be the one that's a Pharisee pounding on their head with my big old Bible. Lord, help me. Consider myself. Help me to humble myself, to be meek, to be humble, and to go and help that person. But the idea here is some people don't want to be restored. Leave me alone. That's the problem with all you people. Butting your nose into my business. Leave me alone. I'm done with you people. And sometimes in church, we know folks like that. We have to pray for them. We have to consider ourselves. We need to love them, even while there's distance. So we must be meek and humble. He's writing to the church. So as we come to prayer, I want to ask you to pray for and help us as we protect the purity of our church. And not just our church family, the family, but each of our homes. I can't do that for you, nor can you do that for me. Where you go, who you speak to, what you watch, what you listen to, what you do with your life, the actions that you take, you are accountable to God. And in the family of God, we are together. Let's pray for the purity of our church. Also, we need to deal with our past. If your past is rising up against you because of who you used to be or what you used to do, and you're a child of God and it's still beating you down, you can't get victory over it, God will deliver you from that. You don't have to be enslaved going back into Egypt to bondage. You can recover from that. That's what the church is for. And maybe you've been hurt, you've been abused, you've been let down, you've been just let go. The Lord says, here I am, I'm here. And I pray that our church family will be that representation that will also embrace and love. And it matters because God loves you and He wants us to love each other. So church is to be a place of safety, truth, love, acceptance, and grace. And it's why it's so important that we are connected. You know, we had a pounding when we came. We didn't know what that was. We first moved here. It was in February of 2014. And they said, Pastor, we're going to give you a pounding. I'm like, so soon? You know, I haven't been here a week. What is a pounding? What are you talking about? Give you a pounding? Well, we want to load you up with canned goods of butternut squash. I'm like, you know what? I think the Methodist Church is looking for a preacher, so I'm going to just, no. We're going to give you cans of this and food with that, and here's gift cards. I'm like, that was the best pounding I ever took. That was awesome. And, you know, we need to do that for one another. When we come to the family of God, when we get together, it's just to be real. You know, we just be who you are in Christ. Not, you know, being weird and all that, but just be who you are in Christ. And we need to give each other a pounding from time to time. Let people know, you know, I love you. You're my family now. You're in God's family, but you're in my family. I love the family that I left in New England. Those people were my family for many years, and I love that family. I miss that family. I spent time with that family, and I'll be with that family in heaven one day. But you're my family. And when you look across the audience and you look across the pew, you see the family. So let's approach Scripture that is tough like family. We're at the dinner table. We're talking to one another. Lord, help us as we talk to one another so that we'll deal with difficult subjects because it pleases you, it helps us, and Lord, you have a plan for our lives. Let's pray. Before we take our offering, I want to introduce some folks to you this morning. You met Maya, as she likes to be called, but this is Richard and Jessica Bomback, and they recently moved from Texas. And Richard and Jessica are in Christian camping and moved here in April, I believe it was. And they are now the executive director of the YMCA camp, administrative assistant. And their two daughters is Annabelle and Maya. Maya, of course. Oh, do you have them? Yeah. Oh, here they come in. There's Addison as well. Oh, wait, let's see. Yeah. I think we have everybody here. Let me just make sure with our announcements too as we get it. I don't want to leave anything out here. Yeah, here they come. We wanted to make sure that they could be here. So Richard and Jessica moved here from Texas, and we're thankful that their daughters have been coming to Awana, and she had the conversation about her salvation and baptism, And we had already been texting and talking, and then they came to meet with me on Wednesday and shared their story of how they've been in Christian camping for a number of years. And Richard's story, even with a cancer survivor and what God did, is just really amazing. And I'm sure you're going to hear that story. But they said, we want to come to join the church. We want to be a part of the church family. We found our home. The girls love it, and we love it. And it's just inspiring to hear what God is doing in their life even now at the camp. Then we have another Jessica. We have Richard and Jessica and their kids. And now we have Josh and Jessica and their kids. We have Addison and Caden and Madeline. And Josh is a 21-year vet police officer in Duval. See, I thought he was in Middleburg at Clay, so he's a police officer. He worked last night and he's here today. And Jessica is a nurse, but also a stay-at-home mom. And Madeline's a soccer player at Trinity Baptist College, just got saved a couple of weeks ago, praise the Lord. And then we have Caden and Addison, who've been coming to Awana, and they just recently moved right over here. And they've been coming and visiting throughout the summer and sitting in the back, and news got to me through my wife. They had spoken to her, says, you know, we just found a home here. And both groups, as we were talking this morning even, they said the one thing, there are people just that are loving, that are caring. They just come up and talk to us and just are very special. And we just felt at home. And I said, well, praise the Lord for that. So we have the Griffiths and the Bombach. So I'm going to ask you guys to come up and stand if you would. And we want to just welcome them into our church family. How many say we'd like to welcome the Griffiths and the Bombachs into Freedom Baptist Church? Would you do so by saying amen or lifting your hand? Amen. Praise the Lord. Let's give them a hand. Amen. Amen. And what we'll do at the close of service, and by the way, he's an Alabama fan or Georgia fan. Okay, I know. He was sweating it last night, I know. He's a Gator fan. So Georgia fans, just go to that end and you can avoid it. And we got an Oklahoma State guy right here, right there, so Cowboy. But at the end of service, after our offering, if you want to come and just shake their hands, welcome them into the church, give them a pounding, man, we love that. But we're so blessed to have them in our church, won't you?